the name of Jesus Christ, who will return to judge the living and the dead, dear brothers and sisters in Christ. Text for our meditation this morning comes from Romans chapter 13, as we heard as our second lesson. There was a boy who had been taught the word of God by his mother as a child, but his father was a pagan, was an unbeliever. And this boy grew up knowing the Bible stories that his mother was teaching him, but it seemed that his indifference to his mother's teaching and to those stories seemed to just grow with his age. And as he grew older, it seemed that the mischief just seemed to take over. There was one occasion in particular that he remembered looking back on his life where he and his friends were playing out in the streets, and they played their games so late into the evening for the very purpose that when it was late, they would be able to go over into their neighbor's yard and steal some of the pears that were on the trees in their neighbor's orchard. And do you know what they did with those pears as they were stealing them? You could just imagine this band of little hooligans running around, gathering up pears. And what did they do but take one bite out of each of them, and then they threw them to the pigs? You see, they weren't stealing because they were hungry, nor were they stealing because those pears were better than the pears that they had in their own kitchen. They were simply stealing for the mischief of it. Later, this man looked back on this occasion and said, "It was the sport of it which tickled our hearts. It was the company of a band of little sinners running around having fun sinning." Some people might say, well, that's just kids being kids. But later he looked back with regret on the deep evil that he saw in his heart, sinning simply for the sake of sinning. Well, not too long after this incident, the man grew up a little bit and he became old enough to go off to school. And so off he went, off away from his mother and her stories, off away from God and his word, off to become a man and to garner both prestige and pleasure. And so off he went, he thought, to love and to be loved. But later he learned that he simply was incapable. He could not discern the clear brightness of love from the fog of lustfulness. And it was in that cloud of lustfulness that he lived for a number of years, giving himself to the pleasures that he had fallen in love with. Soon he had fathered a child in that love, as he called it, but he never took that woman to be his wife. In his school and in his career, he became enamored with the wisdom and the rhetoric of this world, so much so that he even went off to join what we would basically call today a cult. And in all of his wondering and wandering, he never found what it is he was looking for, to love and be loved. In fact, he found himself far from it. About that time in his life, this is what he said: "I sank away from thee and I wandered, O my God, too much astray from thee, my stay, in these days of my youth, and I became to myself a barren land." Eventually, he had wandered so far that he actually started to wander someplace a little bit more familiar to him, familiar from long ago. He ended up wandering back through the doors of the church, where he heard the preaching that took place there and where the word of God met him in his sin. The struggle of his soul intensified to the point where it all came down on him one evening. He remembered the night when a deep consideration had from the secret bottom of my soul drawn together and heaped up all my misery in the sight of my heart, there arose a mighty storm, bringing a mighty shower of tears. Because his conscience was literally killing him. It was tearing him apart. And in that state, he had to go off to be alone. He left the company of his friend and he went off where his conscience continued to torture him. He remembered crying out, "How long, Lord? How long, Lord, will you be angry forever? Remember not our former iniquities." And in that vulnerable, frenzied state, he remembered hearing a voice, the voice of a little child who was like singing or chanting, like in a game, kept on saying, "Take up and read, take up and read." And confused as he was, because he knew that he was all alone, there was nobody else around him, and there was no reason that there would have been a child playing some game somewhere shouting these words, he obeyed the command, and he took up his Bible, and he read. And the first words that he read were the words of our sermon text this morning from Romans chapter 13. "The hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is nearly over. The day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us behave decently as in the daytime, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy. Rather, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the flesh." Those words were for him a lightning bolt, life-changing moment. And after he read those words, he remarked, "No further would I read, nor needed I. For instantly, at the end of this sentence, by a light as it were of serenity infused into my heart, all the darkness of doubt vanished away." See, these words had brought him to repentance. These were the words of God bringing a lost boy back, bringing him body and soul back to the God that he had known all along. These words set his eyes once again on Christ, the Savior that his mother had been teaching him since he was a little boy. And who was this lost little boy that God brought back to repentance as a young man? His name was Augustine. Augustine lived in the 4th and 5th century, and years later, after being baptized and thoroughly instructed in the teachings of that faith, years later he became a priest, and actually one of the most prominent of the early church fathers. And his teaching and his understanding of grace had a huge impact on an Augustinian monk who lived about 11 centuries later named Martin Luther. Maybe one of the quotes that you might recognize from Augustine most of all is one that pastors tend to use quite often. You might recognize it from his writing, The Confessions. "You have made us for yourself, O Lord, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you." Now, why bother to tell you all of this about Augustine today? Well, it's because those words from Romans chapter 13 that woke him up from his spiritual slumber are the same words that come to us today and need to go off in our hearts like an alarm clock and wake us up like a good mother coming into our room and saying, "It's time to wake up and get dressed. Because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The end is coming, the time is near, and we need to be ready." maybe the deer hunters among us found again this past week, how impossible it is to get a deer while you're still laying in bed under the cozy covers. No, that doesn't work. You need to wake up when the hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber, when the night is nearly over and the day is almost here. It's time to get out there and be ready and be watching, because you never know when it's going to come. So it is with the end. So it is with Christ's second coming. It will come like a thief, Jesus says, at the hour that you least expect it. And so what do we need to do to be ready? Paul says, let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. We need to change our clothes. We need to take off the dirty laundry from yesterday so that we're not wearing the same old dirty clothes again. We take off the deeds of darkness, the sins that we love to fall into in the cover of night when we think no one's watching or no one's paying attention. Paul tells us in another place just what those deeds are like. He says, for those who sleep, they sleep at night, and those who get drunk, get drunk at night. And with the deeds of the night come the host of other vices that Paul talks about, the carousing, excessive overeating and feasting and drunkenness to go with it. And a little alcohol will grease the wheels to fall into other sins, like sexual immorality, the giving in and indulgence of our wild sexual desires. And when all that has happened, do we think it will bring the peace and happiness that we were longing for? No. It brings destruction. It brings broken relationships. It brings hurt. It brings people that have been cheated on. It brings dissension and jealousy. But all of those things belong to the night. All of those things belong to the darkness. And Paul says, you are all children of the light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. So let us put on the armor of light. Let us behave decently as in the daytime, not in all of those wild sins. Paul says, not even to think about how to gratify the desires of our flesh, because those things lead us away from God. Those things put us into a drunken spiritual slumber. And if we stay in that slumber and Jesus returns, we will die in that slumber. And there will be no second chances. There will be no excuses to say, I overslept, or I set my alarm for p.m. instead of a.m. It will just be over, like it was for all the wicked in the days of Noah when the flood came and took them all away, and the end came. And so it is time for us to wake up from our spiritual slumber. You know the sins that you are prone to the most, the ones that have the blankets pulled over your eyes, the one that has you stuck in bed. Paul says, the hour has already come to wake up from your slumber, to take off the clothes of yesterday by confessing our sins to God and to the people that we've sinned against. Maybe it's our spouse, or maybe it's our parents, or maybe it's our boss, or our pastor, to confess our sins and strip off those old clothes, because everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be plainly seen that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. This is maybe the hardest and most necessary place for us to be in our entire lives, in the light, exposed before God so that he can see us just as we are And standing there in the light before our God, he does not leave us there to die in the cold. Instead, he gives us new clothes to wear. Paul tells us, rather clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, you get to put on Christ in all of his perfection and all of his holiness and all of his strength to fight against temptation and the devil. You get to put it on and it becomes your own. And you know what you have as the most wonderful assurance that all of this truly is yours, that you have a new set of clothes to wear? Because at your baptism, Christ came to you with water and the word that touched your body and washed away your sin so that you can be sure that you have a new pair of clothes to wear. Paul tells us in another place, for all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. You are God's child. You are a child of the light. And now when God looks at you, he's not angry anymore, as Augustine and Martin Luther always expected him to be. He doesn't even remember our former sins, the sins of our youth. He looks at you and sees his holy and perfect child dressed and ready to go, ready for his return. Brothers and sisters in Christ, it's time to wake up and put on these new clothes every day. It's time to wake up and get dressed with the clothes of our baptism, daily dying to our sin and rising in our baptism to live a new life so that we are ready with the prayer on our hearts, come, Lord Jesus, amen. Please stand. Thanks so much for worshiping with us today. We hope that God's word has strengthened your faith. To help us know more about the reach of our efforts here at Mount Olive, we hope that you'll like and subscribe to our YouTube and Facebook pages, and that you also sign our online friendship register to let us know that you're listening today. God bless and keep you.